We meet in the name of God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit, God is one.
Good morning. It's great to be here at St. Peter's Church, Whitstable, for our Trinity Sunday act of worship. Now, as many of you will know, I am team vicar of All Saints, Whitstable, but I am also team vicar of St. Peter's, Whitstable. And I thought it would be lovely to celebrate the Eucharist from St. Peter's this morning, so that I can truly minister to my St. Peter's congregation as well as to my All Saints congregation. And it is a very special Sunday because it is Trinity Sunday. And that is one of the most special days of the year. So sad that the seats behind me can't be full of members of the congregation, joining us in worship today, but that is just the reality of life still under the current conditions. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. And we say together the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments, and to live in love and peace with all. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been, help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And the collect for today, Trinity Sunday. Almighty and everlasting God, you have given us your servants grace by the confession of a true faith to acknowledge the glory of the eternal Trinity, and in the power of the divine majesty to worship the unity. Keep us steadfast in this faith, that we may evermore be defended from all adversities, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we have our first reading.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 40, beginning at verse 12. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand and marked off the heavens with a span, enclosed the dust of the earth in a measure, and weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance? Who has directed the Spirit of the Lord, or as his counsellor has instructed him? Whom did he consult for his enlightenment, and who taught him the path of justice? Who taught him knowledge and showed him the way of understanding? Even the nations are like a drop from a bucket and are accounted as dust on the scales. See, he takes up the isles like fine dust. Lebanon would not provide fuel enough, nor are its animals enough for a burnt offering. All the nations are as nothing before him. They are accounted by him as less than nothing and emptiness. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We sing our offertory hymn. And now we have our gospel reading.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
May I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, it's great to be preaching from St. Peter's Church this morning on a subject that I really enjoy thinking about, which is the Trinity. Now, I did a sermon not long ago online about the Lord is my shepherd, and I used visual illustrations to help with the sermon. And I thought on this occasion I will be able to bring in some visual illustrations to help with my sermon this morning, as the Trinity is not always the easiest thing to explain, and in fact there is quite a lot of mystery surrounding it anyway. What I would say at the beginning of this sermon is that reflecting and considering the theme of the Trinity and thinking about the nature of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is very important to our spiritual lives, because understanding who God is will help us immeasurably in our spiritual life. If we think of God just as Father, or for many people, an old man with a white beard up in the sky, God, it's very easy for us to think of God as someone distant. If, as many churches think of God, people tend to often only think of God as Jesus. That may not be very familiar to you if you're used to traditional churches, but I've been to many modern churches where only Jesus is referred to, and the Father is very rarely referred to. That may be, it's not the case of all modern churches, of course, but I have been to some churches where the focus on Jesus is so much that the Father is not mentioned very much. And the Spirit, in some translations of the Spirit, there's the female word used there, which I think is really important, because otherwise God can seem very male. And the Spirit is the presence of the Holy Spirit who's with us in the Trinity. Of course, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit in eternity doesn't have gender in the way that we understand anyway. But I think that the feminine understanding of the Spirit is helpful. And in fact, God can often be described as mother too, as we know from the Psalms. Well, I think that's enough of an introduction to this sermon. I'm now going to show you some pictures which will hopefully explain a little bit more. In understanding the Trinity, it's important to understand a little bit about church history. Round about the 3rd and 4th century AD, there was a lot of discussion in the church about who Jesus was. And understanding this debate helps us to understand the Trinity. On one hand was Arius, a Libyan presbyter and ascetic, a priest from Baukalis in Alexandria, Egypt. He believed that Jesus was subordinate to the Father, that he was not of the same status as God the Father. And although he saw Jesus as being worthy of worship, the humanity of Jesus was stressed primarily, and his secondary nature to God the Father. Now, this understanding of Jesus as not fully divine, not fully the same as God the Father, is actually quite a common belief in today's world, and even in the church. I was interested when the Da Vinci Code came out, how many church people I met seemed to relate to the understanding of Jesus as a normal human being. For example, in the Da Vinci Code, Jesus goes on to marry Mary Magdalene and live in southern France. And the divine nature of Jesus is, according to Teabing, a conspiracy by the church. Now, I don't believe that that is historically accurate for reasons I will explain in a minute. But the point really is that according to Arius and according to the Da Vinci Code, the Trinity cannot really exist in any formal way, because Jesus does not share the same nature as God the Father
is not of the same status as God the Father and does not share the same substance as God the Father. The other side of the argument, we find Apollinarius, who was around again in the 3rd and 4th century AD, at the same time as Arius, slightly later, and he took the opposite view from Arius, and his theology is known as Docetism. And basically, Docetism means that Jesus was fully divine, he came from heaven, like we believe in the incarnation at Christmas, but that he did not become fully human. He was fully divine, but didn't, as it were, belittle himself by becoming enmeshed in human flesh and entrapped in human flesh and suffering real pain. So the incarnation for Apollinarius is not something where Jesus became fully human. And when you see a statue like this one of Jesus, it's typical of a very grand Jesus who is in some way above and beyond the incarnation, although maybe you see that statue differently. Now, the Council of Chalcedon, in 451 AD, was the important council that met to discuss all of this, who was Jesus. And it was at this council that the very seeds of the theology surrounding the Trinity was firmly established. Although, of course, as many Christians historians have commented, the belief that Jesus was divine was found much earlier in church writings. It's another thing that the Da Vinci Code gets wrong, because if you go back to the 1st and 2nd and 3rd century, there were plenty of writers and theologians who believed Jesus was divine. But it was at the Council of Chalcedon, that this was firmly established by the church, that Jesus was fully God, that he shared the same nature of God, and he shared the same humanity as us. So he was fully human and fully divine. And I will explain in a minute why this is important to our understanding of the Trinity. Now, you will all know the creed that we say in church, which we will be saying later during this service, which talks about the very findings of the Council of Chalcedon. Of one substance with the Father, through him all things were made. And I will show you that when we say the creed later today, later in this service. Now, let's get away from all that history and speak practically about what this means for our understanding of the Trinity. Well, there are different understandings of the Trinity. In this picture, which comes from a church in Moscow, we see the Father as very much the central figure of the Trinity, and Jesus and the Spirit as smaller characters. It's as if the Father sent the Son to die on the cross for a purpose, and Jesus has a functional role. He merely is the one who carries the sins of the world, but it's the Father who is the eminent one. The Spirit is also subordinate to the Father and Jesus in this picture. This is an image of the Trinity that, for me, is not particularly helpful. It seems to share something of the Arius view that Jesus is subsidiary or less significant than the Father. Now, why is that not helpful? Because if we only locate the nature of God in the Father, if we only see God as the Father and Jesus as not truly part of God, we can end up with a view of God which is less than helpful. This is a picture of God painted by Michelangelo from the Sistine Chapel in Rome, and it's a picture of God creating the planets. And it's an image of God that for me carries echoes in parts of the Old Testament. An angry God, a God who is a destroyer as well as a creator. I know that in this picture God is creating, but his expression on his face is quite an angry one. And when we don't locate Jesus in the Trinity, when we don't think that Jesus is divine, the problem is we end up with a view of God which can be very, very much this image. We can take passages from the Old Testament which talk about a God who is similar to the image we see in this picture. For example, as I've often said in sermons, passages from the conquest when Joshua comes into the promised land and God orders all the tribes to be slaughtered, women, men, children and animals. These verses in the Old Testament can give us a view of God the Father as an angry God. And if Jesus himself is not part of the Trinity, and if the Spirit is not part of the Trinity, if we only have God as part of the Trinity, then we can be left with an angry God. There are much more helpful images of the Trinity, which, for example, can be found in some iconography. You will probably know this icon of the Trinity by Andrei Rublev from the 15th century. In this picture, it is actually meant to originally be of the three angels who visited Abraham. But many, many commentators and theologians have seen it also as an icon of the Trinity. This seems to have something much more in common with what the Council of Chalcedon was trying to say, that the Father and the Son and the Spirit are three persons which share a similar nature and essence. In fact, the Trinity with the Spirit wasn't the main focus of Chalcedon, but that's a subsidiary matter. The point is that this icon is an image of three persons who are very similar in the sense of they share similar status, and they are working together for the common good. The left-hand angel actually symbolizes God the Father. He is the one blessing the cup, yet his hand is painted in a distance, as if he passes the cup to the central angel. The central angel, it is thought, represents Jesus Christ, who in turn blesses the cup as well as accepts it with a bow, as if saying, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not I will, but as your will." The nature of each of the three is revealed through their symbolic attributes. On the right is the Spirit. The wings of the two angels on the left, the Father and the Son in the middle, interlap. The blue colour of the Son's robe symbolises divinity. The wings of the Holy Spirit do not touch the Son's wings. They are imperceptibly divided by the Son's sphere. But nonetheless, this image is one of three persons in one. Three persons gathered around the cup of suffering. And for many people, it is an expression of relationship, love, unity, humility, as the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit coalesce around this cup of the Eucharist. Now, This is the Celtic knot. And this is another image of the Trinity that some people find helpful. Again, you have three shapes or three corners of the triangle, but the three seem to weave into each other in almost a mystical way, with a circle also gathering all three parts together. All three corners are identical, and yet it is both three shapes and one shape together, with the circle, which could represent love, uniting us all. This is a very good example of the Trinity, and I have learned myself a lot from Celtic theology about God's love, getting away from an angry God with a grey beard, and instead looking at an image for God, which is love, humility, self-sacrifice, and serving each other within the bond of love. At my theological college, Dr. Jeremy Begbie, Reverend Dr. Jeremy Begbie, felt that the knot wasn't that good because the three corners of the knot are identical, whereas the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are different. And he used the image of a three-note chord of music to represent the Trinity. And I think I can see his point. I'm just about to play you a video recording of a chord that I did earlier this week. And you'll see that they are three separate notes, but they are one chord. And in some senses, this is even better than the image of the Celtic knot. Here comes my recording of the three-noted chord. This is a stained glass window that was given to me by Charles Judd, who was a wonderful craftsman. Now, it is not held against the window in this picture, but when you hold it against the window, light comes through in different ways. And many people think that the Trinity is similar, that the light comes through in different ways. There is a mystery about it. We don't fully understand it. But I do hope my talk has helped to explain a little bit about how I view the Trinity. That the Trinity is not about a God the Father being the sort of supreme presence, but is instead symbolic of a relationship of love. Now, very important of all, we have to say, does this mean that God is only located in the visible church? Because Jesus is such a foundational part of the Trinity. Well, this is a complex question, but let me explain a little bit about what I think about this. Jesus was a historical person, I have no doubt about it. But the mystical presence of Christ and the presence of the Holy Spirit are the presence of the divine on earth, both in incarnate form through the body of Christ and in spiritual form. And I have no doubt that the presence of Christ can be found beyond the visible church. By that I mean the presence of God can be found in other expressions of religion and even in the presence of good people who are not religious. We certainly read in the book of Colossians that the presence of Christ can be found in creation and that that spirit rests in all things. So it's very important when we talk about the Trinity, that we don't make it an exclusive image or concept. It is a mystical concept, and it doesn't mean that Christ isn't at work beyond the visible church. Christ is present in the broken and the lost. as Jesus himself says in Matthew 25, I was in prison, but you did not visit me. I was sick, but you did not visit me. Christ is present in the calls of injustice that we're hearing in the United States of America at the moment. And indeed, the image of the Trinity would be a very helpful model for all those in authority in the United States to reflect on, because it doesn't reflect a patriarchal, angry God of justice and vengeance, but a God of humility and love. Finally, may I just say that you may well have grown up with an image of God as God the Father, and the whole idea of the Trinity could be just completely not in your mind or in your being in a natural sense. That's because so much teaching has not taught Trinitarian theology. I have no hesitation in saying that an understanding of the Trinity is foundational to my spiritual happiness. It's more important than how much I pray. It's more important than how hard I work. It's more important than anything else, because if we can understand God as love, as a God who serves, who gives of himself, who lives in relationship, who is a mixture of the male and the feminine, as I said earlier, who is beyond time and space, and whose presence can be found beyond the institutional church, then we can have real confidence that God really is love, that God loves you, he loves me, his spirit of love is present throughout the world, and he wants us to find that love through an encounter with him. I do hope that you found that explanation helpful and that it helps you to understand who God is, that God loves you, that God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and that he is with you today on Trinity Sunday. You know, I used to wonder why so many weeks of the Anglican calendar were devoted to Trinity, but actually thinking about it, if we can understand the Trinity, it really does help us so much in our spiritual lives, that devoting nearly half of the entire year to the Trinity season is actually a very good thing. And let us pray that by the end of the Trinity season, later in the autumn, we will be able to worship together fully then, if not before then. Who knows? I have no idea what's going to happen, whether there'll just be social distancing worship or something more involving us all. I do not know. But I'm with you and praying with you. I know that you're missing being at All Saints and St. Peter's and the other team churches and any church that you belong to.
We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, being of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Lord God, our Creator, you have given us the good earth to be our home and each other to be our companions, so that we may live in strong and creative community. We offer our prayers for your world, that diseases of the body may soon be eradicated and troubles of the mind may soon give way to peace and hope. We remember before you people we know who particularly need our prayers today. We ask that by the power of your Spirit within us, we may help to bring healing to the sick in body, mind, and spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God of all peoples, we pray for peace and justice in your world, that people may respect and value each other, no matter their ethnic origin, that children may honour their parents and parents their children, that everyone alive may soon have fresh water to drink and food enough to eat, that human ambition may be used to serve your divine cause in humanity, that hate, suspicion and prejudice will soon give way to love, that despair will soon be consumed by hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God of all our hopes, we thank you for coming to live our life on earth in Jesus. We thank you that through him we know that you know the joys and sorrows of the human condition. By the power of your Spirit in us, lead us towards love and hope and trust in your mercies. Show us how to be merciful. Enable us to use the vast resources of love you have given us to bring healing to your people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, lead us more and more into the mystery of your divine love. Give us insight to live in your presence and encourage us, as we encourage others, to serve and trust you, our Maker, our Brother, our Enabler, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
God is love, and those who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you.
The Lord is here, his Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts, we lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For with your only begotten Son and the Holy Spirit, you are one God, one Lord. All that you reveal of your glory, the same we believe of your Son, and of the Holy Spirit, without any difference or inequality. We, your Holy Church, acclaim you, Father of majesty unbounded, your true and only Son, worthy of all worship, and the Holy Spirit, advocate and guide. Three persons we adore, one in being and equal in majesty. And so with angels and archangels, with cherubim and seraphim, we sing forever of your glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Accept our praises, Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. Who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Accept through him, our great High Priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise, and as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit, inspire us with your love, and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours for ever and ever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. grant us peace. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. The body of Christ. The blood of Christ. Almighty and eternal God, you have revealed yourself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and live and reign in the perfect unity of love. Hold us firm in this faith, that we may know you in all your ways, and evermore rejoice in your eternal glory, who are three persons yet one God, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Thank you very much to all of the leaders, Elena, Jeff, and all of you who are doing so much good work with the children. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen. Hello.